गुड मॉर्निंग, नमस्कार, वेलकम टू हॉट टॉक 61। टुडेज स्पीकर इज डॉक्टर ओपी चौहान, साइंटिस्ट एफ डीएफआरएल डीआरडीओ मैसूर। ही विल स्पीक ऑन रिसेंट एडवांसेस इन द पोस्ट हार्वेस्ट टेक्नोलॉजीज ऑफ हॉर्टिकल्चरल क्रॉप्स। ऑन द बिहाफ ऑफ प्रोग्रेसिव हॉर्टिकल्चर, आई शिव प्रताप वेलकम द स्पीकर डॉक्टर ओपी चौहान एंड यू ऑल टू दिस एडिशन ऑफ हॉट टॉक। Now I request Dr. O.P. Chauhan to start the talk. Sir, please.
Thank you, Dr. Shiv Pratap Singh ji, and thank you to the Progressive Horticulture for inviting me for this talk today on 21st February 2021. I am Dr. O.P. Chauhan. I did my master's and PhD from G.V. Pant University of Agriculture and Technology, Pantnagar, in the area of food technology. And since last 2004, I am working at Defense Food Research Laboratory, Mysore. I am heading the Division of Fruits and Vegetable Technology Division at DFRL, Mysore. So my basic research areas are post-harvest handling of fruits and vegetables, plantation crops, and development of value-added products. So this is my brief. And apart from this, I am also handling some LSRB, that is Life Sciences Research Board. And I'm handling one panel of this board. That is on food science, hill agriculture, biofuel, and bioresources that deal with the funding of the research project to the universities and institutes. So this is brief about me. So with this introduction, I would like to start my presentation, that is on recent advances in post-harvest technologies of horticultural crops. So in this lecture, I would like to cover basically two things. One is handling of fruits and vegetables in fresh form or partially cut form. And second thing will be development of value-added products and different technologies which are recently being used for development of value-added products as well as handling of fresh fruits and vegetables. Before this, I would like to tell a couple of minutes about DFRL and DRDO. DFRL, that is Defense Food Research Laboratory, it is under the Ministry of Defense. And it comes under Defense Research and Development Organizations. And it was established in Mysore in 1961 to cater the food logistic requirement of armed forces. Them as per their requirements. Our vision is to be a technological leader of excellence in food research. And DFRL mission is design, develop, and evaluate safe, nutritious, and convenient foods to meet the needs of the services and as well as whatever technologies we are developing that has to reach to the civilian population also. So we give technology transfer and more than 600 technologies at present. DFRL technologies at present are being used by different food industries in India. We are having core competence in the area of development of convenience and ready-to-eat food products, ready-to-eat as well as convenience means. Yes, we are testing and evaluation. So this is our strength at DFRL, and with this we are supporting to the services like Army, Navy and Air Force in the terms of operational rations like meals, ready-to-eat ration. We are providing potable water, compo pack ration, mini compo pack ration, flying rations for Air Force, emergency flying ration, personal survival pack rations, then tank crew ration, submarine ration, Marcos, marine commandos ration, pre-flight meals as well as in-flight meals for Air Force. Then we are having certain accessories also like sea dye marker. If suppose somebody is there in sea, he can use this sea dye marker and Air Force can rescue him. Then self-heating system for different type of food products. It is based on chemical heaters. Now we have developed that battery operated and solar operated heaters also. Then curd making machine for high altitude locations where temperature is always in negative side. So their curd making is a problem. So we have made certain machines for making curd in high altitude locations. Then antifreeze containers, again for high altitude location to prevent the freezing of fruits and vegetables at Siachen or Ladakh sector. So these type of things we are doing in brief at DFRL Mysore, and these are our major technologies. We are having expertise in retard pouch processing technology that is used for making this MRE rations, meals ready to eat rations. Then we are having technology for freeze dehydration, microwave food processing technology, infrared processing for insect infestation control, hurdle technology for fruits and vegetables, mineral processing for fruits and vegetables again, vacuum frying, that is a very good technology for frying sugar rich products. Irradiation facility also we are having. Then we are pioneering non-thermal technologies also at DFRL Mysore, basically high pressure processing as well as pulse electric processing. So these two systems we have installed for the first time in India, and we are working since 2007-8 on these technologies. Then whatever technologies we are developing, that has to reach to the civilian population also. So we have given more than 600 technologies. Then we are supplying rations to different type of security agencies also, like security guards or other paramilitary forces. Then we are also providing food products to the Antarctica expedition. Recently, December, again, our ship has moved to Antarctica expedition, and we have given the food, all the food products to meet their 3 months requirement. Then again, we are working on space missions also. Recently, you might have heard that Gaganyaan first manned flight is going next year to space. And we are providing that different type of food products as well as delivery systems for space application. Then we are having certain social responsibilities also. So we are providing, if any calamities or anything is there, we are providing food products to the affected areas, like earthquakes, the cyclone affected areas, or floods or tsunami, or different type of calamities are happening in different times. So we have provided different type of food products to meet the requirements of the local population. So this was brief about DFRL and DRDO, what we are doing at DFRL and DRDO. Now coming to the today's topic, that is advances in post-harvest handling or post-harvest technologies of fruits and vegetables. So we can just see that India having a huge population also, and as well as we are having huge production of fruits and vegetables also. At present, we are second largest producers of fruits and vegetables. Apart from fruits and vegetables, we are also largest producer of cereals or milk. Our livestock population is also there. And as we are talking about fruits and vegetables, we can see most of the fruits and vegetables are grown in India. This is due to the presence of different type of agroclimatic zones in India, different type of soils present in Indian conditions. So, and we are having better sunshine hours also. Day lengths are bigger so that we can get better quality of fruits and vegetables. And our 50%, 52%, more than 50% cultivable lands is available in India. So this is that scenario. And we are having a very good opportunity to become a global sourcing hub for fruits and vegetables. So, and if you see the fruits and vegetable production, last few years data, you can see that fruit production about, we are reaching around 100 million tons, and vegetable production about more than 180 million tons. So this is the huge production. But apart from this production is continuously increasing every year. And you can see that major fruits and vegetables, they are grown in India, suppose, and major share is for banana. Suppose 40% share goes to banana, followed by mango, citrus, papaya, guava, apple. So these are the major fruits generally grown in India. Similarly, in the case of vegetables also, you can see potato is having the major share, whereas tomato, onion, brinjal, tapioca, and other vegetables are also grown in different part of the country. And if you can see state-wise production also, Tamil Nadu is, suppose in the case of food producing state, Tamil Nadu is the major producer of fruits, followed by Maharashtra, Andhra, Gujarat, Karnataka, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar. So these are the major food producing states in India. Similarly, in the case of vegetables, West Bengal is the topmost in vegetable production, followed by UP, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Andhra Pradesh, Gujarat, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Odisha, like that. So these are the major producing fruits and vegetable states. And if you see the ground reality, already I told, we are the largest producer of fruits and vegetables, second largest producer of the fruits and vegetables. And in India, our that cost of production, that is very cheap, and farmers are similarly, at the same time, farmers are also getting very less income from this crops. So this is the basic problem. And because of these problems are due to the that most of the technologies what we are developing at laboratory conditions or in agriculture universities or institutes, they are the transfer of technology from lab to the land is little slower rate. So that we have to think and we have to further work in this direction. And because of all these things, still, when 10 years back also, we are telling that 25-30% losses are there in fruits and vegetable sector. So again, after 10 years in 2020, 2021 also, we are telling same thing, 25-30% losses. So these losses are more or less looking constant. So same time that production has also increased, so that same time that losses also increasing. So in terms of losses, if you calculate, it is more than consumption of fruits and vegetables in UK. So that much produce, less produce fruits and vegetables we are just spoiling in India every year, and it is crossing more than 1 lakh crore now. Low level of value addition is still in India. That value addition is very poor. That companies, that processing industries, they are little less, and multinational companies, now they are coming to India and they are installing different type of plants, processing plants. So that now that situation is little improving. Similarly, seasonality, production is not constant. Suppose this year mango crop is very good, next year we cannot predict that crop will be good or not. So that seasonality also, that's why that industry also suffers sometimes. If they are not getting the raw material, their production will be hampering. So there is non-efficient storage, warehousing, processing and marketing techniques, non-adaptation of efficient technologies. Because this most of the farmers, but they are having the fields or agriculture land, they are like they are having very less amount of that agriculture land, 1 to 2 acres or something, that farmhouse also little in that area also. So mostly what they do, they consume most of their crops, and little amount only they go for selling in the market. So that's why that raw material supply to the processing industry is not efficient. So if that proper channel is there for this cultivation and marketing of these type of fresh produce, then industry also will be happy in this regard. Similarly, there is other problems like shortage of electricity, then low area under irrigation, high capital cost for the processing industries, then farm connectivity by road. All those things are still problem areas in Indian conditions. So because of all these problems, still our 35% of the fresh fruits and vegetables are getting spoiled every year, and that is costing about more than 1,000 crores. So you can see that Indian scenario as well as developed country scenarios. In developed countries, what happens, most of the losses occur at the later stage of the supply chain, like during storage, processing, packaging, marketing, or wastage by the computer. Whereas in the Indian condition, most of the crop is lost in field itself or during that primary storage or primary processing or transportation stage. So this is the condition. So we lose most of the crop during that initial stage of the supply chain. And that if you see the processing scenario also, fruits and vegetables is still in India, we are only 2.2% of the total produce we are processing. We are sending to the industries for development of value-added products. So that is also a problematic area. So that's what I was saying, that now that time has come where we can install more food processing industries, so that whatever the produce is there, that can be converted into different value-added products. Why that fruits and vegetables get spoiled during storage? Because these fruits and vegetables, even after harvest also, they behave like a living commodity, like us, like a human being. They respire, they take oxygen, liberate carbon dioxide, and they undergo aging process. So that is we called as ripening or senescence. So after harvest also, fruits and vegetables, all these metabolic activities are happening, and they will be converting there will be different type of chemical changes. So that will lead to the ripening, or that will lead to the senescence and spoilage of the commodity. Similarly, there will be loss of moisture from the surface. It depends on the relative humidity also. If relative humidity is less, loss of moisture will be more, and shriveling will be more in the fruits and vegetables. Suppose today we are taking 1 kg of tomato, tomorrow it will become 950 grams. So that will be the loss to the producer also, loss to the consumer also. There will be loss of carbohydrates and vitamins. Then certain physiological disorders also will be happening during that storage period. Then it can go for fruit growth, in the case of potato, onion, all those things. Then germination, attack of pests and diseases, because these are rich in nutrients, moisture is there, so lot of that pests, diseases, fungus, bacteria, all those things will be growing on the surface of fruits and vegetables, and that will be leading to the spoilage of the fresh fruits and vegetables. So these things we have to control when we are talking about the technologies, when we are talking about storage as well as development of value-added products. So these are the major factors which affect the storage of fruits and vegetables, like temperature. Temperature is the major factor. When you are harvesting the fruits and vegetables, there will be certain increase in the temperature of the commodity, that is called field heat. So if field is not removed, commodity will spoil very fast. And depending on the storage temperature requirement also, commodities have to be stored at their optimum storage temperature. These fruits and vegetables, they are very typical in nature, as it is not applicable in that poultry or meat industry, because after slaughtering of the animal, they can be frozen or they can be chilled. Whereas in the case of fruits and vegetables, each commodity requires specific optimum storage temperature. And if you are keeping that below that optimum storage temperature, that commodity will develop certain type of disorder, that is called as chilling injury. Suppose mango, if you are keeping at 2 degree or 5 degree, it will develop certain black spots on the surface, water soaked areas in the flesh. So all those things are called as chilling injury. Similarly, in the case of banana, papaya also, if you are keeping at low temperature, it will develop certain chilling injury symptoms. Next important thing is relative humidity. If relative humidity is optimum, that is around 85 to 90% or 95%, then that water loss from the surface will be less. If relative humidity is less, like 40-50%, then there will be more shriveling and loss of moisture from the surface of the fruits and vegetables. Next important factor is variety. Certain varieties, they are little hard, and some varieties are softer varieties. Suppose in the case of banana, you can see there is some varieties which are little harder, like Elki, we call in South as Elki small bananas. That is little harder. We can keep that banana for a month also at room temperature. Whereas the other variety, that is little bigger variety, that is called Pachbale, that we can keep only for 3-4 days or 5 days at room temperature. So variety also plays important role in the deciding the storage life of the fruit or vegetable. Then soil and cultural conditions, that agricultural practices, that also affect the quality of the fruits and vegetables after harvest. Stage of maturity, that is very important. If we are harvesting the fruits and vegetables at optimum maturity stage, then only farmer is going to get proper price also for the crop, and that fruit and vegetable will develop or it will ripen properly during storage period. Otherwise, if we are harvesting immature fruits, it will not ripen properly, color will not develop, flavor will not develop, sweetness will not develop. So all these problems will be there, and produce will be sold at little lower price. So that are the problems. So we have to harvest the fruits and vegetables at optimum maturity stage. If any infection is there at the time of harvest, that also affects the post-harvest quality of the fruits and vegetables. Suppose some mango varieties are there will be certain infection, some worm will be there inside the fruit. So that will affect the quality of fruit and vegetable after harvest also. Rate of cooling, very important. I was telling, if you are harvesting the fruits and vegetable, we are giving certain stress to the commodity, and the commodity is in a living state, so it will try to cope up with that stress. So it will respire little at a higher rate. So respiration rate will increase, same time that ATP formation will be more, and temperature of the commodity will increase. So that is called as field heat. So we have to remove that field heat by using certain technologies. I will discuss that technologies later stage. And if you see the Indian condition now, that how the fruits and vegetables are being sold, either in cardboard boxes or wooden boxes, or with some grass or something, straw or some leaves are being put for keeping as a cushioning material for fruits and vegetables during transport and during storage also. So these are like very old conventional practices, and that lead to the spoilage of the commodities at a faster rate. Because suppose that wooden boxes or something is there, it will cause certain scars on the surface of fruits and vegetables. And if any damage is there, it will further invite infection from the fungus, or some bacterial infection will be there. And suppose if packing is not proper, there will be bruising on the surface of the fruits and vegetables, that will also affect the quality. So we have to go for the modern practices like individual packing, individual shrink wrapping, or some tray packing with overwraps, or individual that box packing type of things can be applied for fresh fruits and vegetables, and that will increase to the shelf life also, and it will improve the quality also of the fruits or vegetables. If you see the life of a fruit or vegetable, its quality changes. I was talking about maturity. So this was like fruit set, if you see that quality of the fruit, eating quality of the fruit will increase, and it will go up to a optimum level, and after that it will degrade, it will deteriorate. That is called senescence phase or deterioration phase. So that senescence or deterioration phase can be increased by using certain technologies. Suppose if you are not using any technology, keeping the fruits and vegetable after harvesting, it will have a shelf life of certain days. And if you are using that refrigerated optimum storage temperature condition, shelf life will further increase. And this shelf life can be further increased by using refrigerated CA storage chambers or modified atmosphere storage chambers, controlled atmosphere or modified atmosphere storage chambers. So like this, we can increase the shelf life of fruits and vegetables. Suppose banana, if you are keeping at room temperature 4-5 days, if you are keeping at refrigerated temperature at 13-14 degrees centigrade, it will be life of 1 month or 1.5 months. And if you are same banana, if you are using with refrigerated CA storage, where O2 CO2 ratio can be maintained, optimum O2 CO2 ratio can be maintained, it will be having a shelf life of 3 months, 3.5 months. So that much increase in shelf life can be maintained by using certain different type of post-harvest technologies. So this is for like fresh produce. And most of the things are governed by the respiration rate. If respiration rate is more, shelf life of the produce will be less. So you can see that produce which are having low respiration rate, they are having very long shelf life. Suppose onion, potato, they are having longer shelf life because their respiration rate is less. Whereas green leafy vegetables, banana, mushrooms, they are having very high shelf respiration rate, and their shelf life is very limited, 1 to 2 days only. So our ultimate aim in post-harvest handling or shelf life improvement of fruits and vegetables is to control the respiration rate. So if we are able to control the respiration rate of the commodity, we can improve the shelf life, we can further enhance the shelf life. So most of the technologies what we are using for post-harvest handling of fruits and vegetables for shelf life enhancement, that is dependent on the how we can control the respiration rate. So that is the important thing. So what I am going to talk, most of the technologies will affect the respiration rate, and that will improve the shelf life. Maturity is very important. Maturity, we have to harvest the commodity at optimum maturity. You can see that suppose in the case of banana, we have to harvest the banana at stage one or maximum stage two. Then only whatever we are talking, CA storage or other things, can improve the shelf life. Otherwise, it is not. If you are harvesting at 6-7 stages, already it is in ripened stage, and whatever technologies you are going to imply, it is not going to improve the shelf life. So we have to harvest at optimum maturity stage, then only shelf life enhancement in the case of fresh is possible. Similarly, in the case of mangoes also, you can see the maturity stages, like second stage, you can see where I put the star mark. That is the optimum maturity stage for harvesting of a particular variety of mango. Similarly, in the case of tomato also, you can see that optimum where the color break is there. It is changing from green to reddish color. That is the optimum harvest stage for tomato. So if you are harvesting at that stage, we can increase the shelf life of the tomato for longer duration. Similarly, in the case of pineapple also, you can see that index 2, you can see that is 25% yellowing is there. So that stage is good for harvesting of pineapple. And then it can be stored also, it can be transported also for longer duration. So that is very important thing when you are talking about that post-harvest handling of fruits and vegetables. So maturity stage is very important. If you are harvesting at right maturity stage, we can use different type of post-harvest handling technologies for improvement of the shelf life. Similarly, in the case of papaya also, you can see that 25 to 30% ripe stage is optimum for harvesting. Then only it can be kept for longer duration. So after harvesting, we have to go for pre-cooling. But in Indian condition, still this technology is not being adopted. Whereas you can see in developed countries, this is mandatory during that supply chain management. So pre-cooling, why it is important? Because when you are harvesting the commodity, it will increase the shelf, the temperature of the commodity will slightly increase because due to high respiration rate and formation of high amount of ATP. So that field heat we have to remove by these technologies. So these are certain technologies like force air cooling, where Chilled air is circulated on the surface of fruits and vegetables. Fruits and vegetables can be kept in perforated trays, and forced chilled air can be circulated. It will reduce the temperature of the commodity to an optimum level. This type of mobile vans are also available, where that forced air cooling is operational. At the same time, we can shift the produce from field to the industry or cold rooms also. So these type of things are also available, but in Indian condition, still these type of things are not being used. Then hydrocooling, very important technology for pre-cooling. Here there is dual advantage. It is washing the commodity also, and same time it is removing the field heat. It is chilling the produce also. So this is also a very good technique, where that chilled water is sprayed on the surface of fruits and vegetables. So it will wash also and it will cool also. And after washing with chilled water, again the commodity has to go to the dehumidified chamber, where that surface moisture should be removed. Otherwise, if surface moisture is there on the surface of fruits and vegetables, it will invite infections. These are the commercial hydrocooling chambers. You can see big chambers are available, where entire truck can go inside and it can be checked. Then another technology is ice topping. This is not applicable to all the commodities, but certain commodities like cucumber and other cabbage or this broccoli, they can be chilled using this ice topping method. Vacuum cooling, further more efficient technology, where rate of cooling will be faster as compared to forced air cooling. And here, so this is very good technique and very fast efficient technique for pre-cooling of fruits and vegetables. Heat of respiration, that is another important criteria I was telling, because if you are harvesting, respiration will increase. So that's why we are going for pre-cooling. And during storage also, if you are not maintaining optimum temperature, respiration rate will be further little higher side, and that will lead to the spoilage of the commodity. So fruits and vegetables, suppose you can see that different temperatures, their heat of respiration is higher. If temperature is increasing, respiration rate is increasing. So this is the problematic area. And all the commodities, then we have to go for at optimum storage temperature. Then only it can be kept for longer duration. Similarly, you can see that avocado, banana, mango, any 10 degree change in temperature is causing 3 to 4 times increase in the respiration rate. So that we have to control. So that's why I am telling each fruit and vegetable should be stored at optimum low temperature. Then only that shelf life can be enhanced. Otherwise, if we are not keeping the fruits and vegetables at optimum storage temperature, if you are storing at below this optimum temperature, it will develop certain physiological disorders, that is called as chilling injury. It is not related with freezing injury, because in case of freezing injury, we completely freeze the produce. Whereas in chilling injury, we are just storing the fruits or vegetable below their optimum storage temperature. Suppose banana is there 14 degrees centigrade. If you are keeping at 6 degrees centigrade, it will develop black spots on the surface. Okay, so that is called chilling injury in the banana. Mango, similarly in the case of mango also, that is optimum storage temperature is around 13-14 degrees centigrade. Papaya also more or less same. So if you are keeping that type of commodities at 4 degree or 5 degree, it will develop black spots, water soaked areas, and some other problems, that color will change or flavor will change. So all those things that is related with the chilling injury symptom. Suppose you can see this, some examples I have put here. Suppose okra, that lowest safe temperature is 7 degrees centigrade. If you are keeping below 7 degrees centigrade, it will develop certain discoloration, water soaked areas, pitting, decay. Potatoes 3 to 4 degrees centigrade, tomato 7 to 10 degrees centigrade. If you are keeping below 7 degrees centigrade, there will be water soaking and softening, and further it will decay. So these type of things are there, that is called chilling injury symptoms. So we have to keep the fruits and vegetables at optimum storage temperature only. Not above that also. If we are keeping at above that storage temperature, it will shelf life will be less. If we are keeping below that optimum storage temperature, chilling injury symptoms will appear. Similarly, in other commodities also, you can see if you are keeping at safe optimum temperature, below that safe optimum temperature, different type of chilling injury symptoms will come. Pitting, surface decay, failure to ripen. So these are the symptoms for chilling injury. So once we have kept the fruits and vegetables, first we have to harvest at optimum storage, optimum maturity stage. Then we have to pre-cool it. Then we have to keep the fruits and vegetables at optimum storage temperatures and in cold stores. Then when you are going for ripening, suppose banana we have kept in cold rooms and then we have to shift it to market for consumption, then directly we cannot shift the bananas to the from cold room to the market. It has to go through some ripening process, otherwise it will some treatments we have to give. So that process is called ripening. So in this case of ripening cases, what happens that certain anabolic and catabolic process happens. So certain that like starch will reduce, sugar formation will be there, flavor formation will be there, color formation will be there, pH will slightly increase. So like that, so many things will happen during this ripening process. So this process should be controlled properly. Otherwise, that final quality of the product will not, whatever we are getting in the market, it will give some little bad quality of the product. So ripening is a very important step when you are shifting the produce from cold rooms to the market for consumption. So this type of ripening room should be used where the temperature, humidity, as well as ethylene gas. Ethylene is a ripening hormone that is used for fruits and vegetable ripening. So this three things we have to control in ripening chambers. Then only that optimum quality of the final produce will come. Otherwise, if you are not controlling this temperature, humidity, and ethylene concentration properly, that produce will not ripen properly. It will certain places will be green, or certain places there will be more yellowing, or more that carotenoid formation will be there. So all those things, problems will happen. Suppose you can see, this is the optimum conditions for ripening of different type of fruits and vegetables. I've given some examples. Suppose banana, 100 ppm ethylene we have to give in ripening chamber for 24 to 48 hours. Then only that banana, good quality, ripen, yellow color banana will come. Similarly for mango also, pears, tomato, different type of, that ethylene concentration and temperature and humidity conditions are given in this table. So we have to ripen the fruits and vegetables in ripening chambers. Then only optimum quality of the final produce will come. Suppose this is some experiment you can see. So if where we are giving that 100 ppm ethylene for banana, very good quality yellow color is coming. If you are giving less amount of ethylene, it is not ripening properly. When you are giving 1000 ppm of ethylene, it is over ripened. So if you want to ripen the fruit or vegetable optimally, then we have to give optimum amount of ethylene for it at a optimum temperature and humidity condition, then only very good. Otherwise you can see in market some bananas are there where a lot of black spots are there, means it is not ripened properly. And some bananas, imported banana, you can see where uniform golden yellow color is there. So that is optimally ripened, that is ripened in the ripening chamber. So these technologies we have to imply, then only optimum quality of final produce will come. Ethylene is very sometimes it is good also, sometimes it is bad also. When you want to ripen the fruit or vegetable, we have to give ethylene doses. Then only it will ripen properly. And suppose you want to further enhance the shelf life of fruit or vegetable, ethylene we have to control. Ethylene generation, it is indigenously generated inside the fruit or vegetable. That formation we have to control. Suppose ethylene is formed from methionine by this pathway, so some enzymes are involved. So these enzymes either we can control, or when final ethylene is generated, that ethylene we have to scrub, that ethylene we have to remove from the storage chamber. So if we are there will not be any ethylene, ripening will be delayed. So when we want to enhance the shelf life of fruits or vegetables, we have to remove the ethylene from the storage chamber by certain methods. And when you are going for ripening, then we have to give ripening treatment, ethylene treatment for ripening. So different type of ethylene absorbents are available in market. DFR also, we have developed certain potassium permanganate based ethylene absorbents, and market also different type of ethylene absorbents are available. So if you are putting these type of sachets or chemical inside the storage chambers, it will increase the shelf life of fruits and vegetables. Suppose at room temperature also, if you are putting these type of, it will increase the shelf life by 4 to 7 days or 10 days, depending on the commodity. And if you are keeping this ethylene absorbents in the cold rooms, it will further increase the shelf life. So that is very good technology, very simple and efficient technology for increasing the shelf life of fruits and vegetables. Then certain technologies like different type of coatings are available in the market. As per FSI, Food Safety Standard Authority of India, only few coatings are permitted. That is basically wax based or this Carnauba, Shellac, that type of coatings only permitted in India. So these type of coatings can be applied to the surface of the fruits and vegetables. And it will not, it will provide certain gloss to the surface. Suppose apples, you can see it is glossy. That appearance is very, that shiny type of thing. So the type of shine comes because of the coating material. So wax coating or shellac coating can be used for different type of this fruits and vegetables. It will give glossiness also, and same time it will increase the shelf life also, because this is creating a barrier on the surface of fruit or vegetable that will reduce the this permeability of the gases. Oxygen, carbon dioxide permeability will be reduced, so it will create certain type of modified atmosphere inside the fruit or vegetable that will reduce the respiration rate, and further it will increase the shelf life. That is the principle of the coatings. So it also reduces water loss also, because there is like a hydrophobic type of nature that most of the coating. So it will reduce the water loss, reduce gas diffusion, improve structural properties, improve appearance, protect against contamination or infections, establishes modified atmosphere, and thereby it will increase the shelf life of the fruit and vegetable. So these type of things also can be used for fruits and vegetables to increase the shelf life. These are certain experiments you can see that if you are coating the fruits and vegetables with coatings, it will give improvement in the shelf life. And the technology, very good technology, is shrink wrapping. Now you can market, you can see individual shrink wrap produce or tray packed or shrink wrap produces are available. So that is also very good technology. That packaging materials, it will tightly adhere to the surface of the fruits and vegetables, and it will extend the shelf life by creating certain type of modified atmosphere. It will reduce again that transmission of the gases, as well as it will also reduce the water loss from the commodity. And this commodity is also very look very good in this type of packaging, so marketing also will be easier. Then another technology is modified controlled atmosphere storage, where we try to change the gaseous atmosphere inside the storage chambers. Suppose outside atmosphere, that normal atmosphere, oxygen is 21%, nitrogen 92%, and nitrogen is around 79%, then carbon dioxide around 0.0003%. So all these things, we have to change this oxygen and carbon dioxide levels basically. What we do here, suppose you can see, in the case of respiration, glucose is converted into carbon dioxide, water and energy in the presence of oxygen. So if you reduce the oxygen concentration, rate of reaction will be reduced. Otherwise, you can increase the carbon dioxide concentration, again the rate of reaction will decrease. So by controlling this oxygen and carbon dioxide, either reduce the oxygen or increase the carbon dioxide in the storage chamber. By this, we can control the rate of respiration, and thereby we can control all the metabolic activities in the fruit and vegetable. So further, it will increase the shelf life. So all these fruit and vegetables, they are having different optimum O2 and CO2 requirements for their storage. So we just optimize this O2 CO2 ratio, and then we can control the rate of reaction, rate of respiration, and we can further increase the shelf life of fruits and vegetables. This can be done by two ways, either by active method or by passive method. In case of active method, desired amount of oxygen and carbon dioxide is flushed inside the chambers, and it will be established, and continuously O2 CO2 will be maintained. Same amount of O2 CO2 will be maintained in the cold rooms. So that is called controlled atmosphere storage technology. Sometimes we pack the fruits and vegetables in modified atmosphere films or semi-permeable modified atmosphere films. There, as per the respiration rate and this oxygen and carbon dioxide transmission rate, that permeability of the film, all these things after a certain period of time, they will come into some equilibrium, and it will maintain a O2 optimum O2 CO2 ratio inside the flexible pouch. So this is like we call as passive modified atmosphere technique. So permeability of the film for O2 CO2 and respiration rate, that we have to match, and then a modified atmosphere will be generated inside the flexible polymeric film. This is the some control panels, how that CO storage is maintained, where O2 CO2 temperature, humidity, all these four parameters are controlled inside the storage chambers by using certain pumps and different type of generator, O2 CO2 generators and other things. This is a small CA chamber where we are controlling temperature and humidity, and with cylinders we are flushing the optimum amount of O2 CO2 inside the chambers. So this is a small chamber at DFRL, what we are doing, using for the different experimental purposes. And similarly, we are having in next slide that this second one, where and that packing system is there where the different type of packaging films or plug-in films can be used, and here O2CO2 again from the cylinders can be flushed inside the packaging, flexible packaging, that is called as modified atmosphere packaging. So controlled atmosphere storage and modified atmosphere packaging, these three things are available at DFR. These are certain experiments you can see where we have used that ethylene absorbents or modified atmosphere shelf life is much better as compared to the control samples. In case of fruits and vegetables, there is another technology we call as minimal processing technology. So this concept has come from that Western world only, where cut fruits and vegetables have been sold in packed conditions. So now in India also, different shopping malls, you can see this type of cut fruits and vegetables are at present are being sold in either tray form or pouches form or in mixed fruit slab form, or different type of things are available in the market. And FSI has given certain standards only for microbial parameters like E. coli should be nil, Salmonella should be nil. All those parameters are given by FSI standards, have been given for this cut fruits and vegetables. Recently, it has come into the practice. So what we have to do here, we have to use different type of phytosanitary measures like chlorine wash or ozone wash or UV treatments. And along with that, certain antimicrobials like class 2 preservatives like sodium benzoate or KMS can be used. Certain acidulants like citric acid can be used, or certain chemicals like ascorbic acid for browning inhibition. All those things can be used for this cut fruits and vegetables. And depending on that shelf life requirement, we can optimize these treatments. Preservative, acidulant, or other treatments can be optimized, or phytosanitary measures can be optimized. So, and at the most, in most of the cases, these cut fruits and vegetables should be stored at lower temperature only, because after cutting, this will be, these are more prone for the microbial infection. So this should be kept at low temperature storage only, at 4 to 6 degrees centigrade in refrigerated conditions. Then another technology is irradiation, where gamma irradiation is being used. And in Indian condition, basically it is used for sprout inhibition of fruits and vegetables. So certain dose level can be given. Basically, it is used for potato and onions only in Indian condition, and certain doses can be given which will inhibit the sprouts so that commodity can be stored for little longer duration. We have developed certain zero energy cold cooling chambers also, where that by sprinkling of water and by the principle of evaporative cooling, that inside temperature can be maintained little lower as compared to the outside temperature, and fresh produce can be kept in type of, in these type of this zero energy cooled chambers, and this can be very much useful for the rural population. Similarly, we are having antifreeze containers which can be used for preventing freezing of fruits and vegetables in altitude locations where most of the time the temperature is below 0 degrees, -20, -30. So whatever fruits and vegetables goes there, it becomes stone type of thing after freezing. So soldiers generally, they have to put in hot water, thaw it, and then they can consume. And by that process, these fruits and vegetables, they lose their quality. So these type of containers has been developed, and it has been supplied to the different army locations, and they are using. Here we can use different type of chemicals also. Inside also, we can put different type of antifreeze liquids. So many technologies are there, and we can use these type of things to prevent freezing of fruits and vegetables at some zero temperatures. These are some trial photographs where we have given our this fruits and vegetables and containers also, and they have gone to the up to the CSN base, and it was not frozen at -30-35 degrees temperature. Quality monitoring is another important thing in case of fresh fruits and vegetables. Generally, fresh fruits and vegetable quality is monitored by destructive methods. Either we have to crush the commodity, take some sample, and then measure pH, acidity, other starch or vitamins, all those things. So now we have developed certain new methods which can, by without cutting the fruit or crushing the fruit, we can monitor the quality of fruit or vegetable. It is like acoustic, based on acoustic methods, or based on electrical impedance method. Acoustic means just by hitting the fruit and measuring the sound quality, we can predict the quality of fruit and vegetable. Similarly, by measuring the electrical conductivity, we can measure the quality of the fruit and vegetable. Here you can see, suppose this is for papaya. So raw, semi-ripe, ripe, overripe. So if you are just hitting the fruit by certain hammer and measuring that sound frequency, you can see that when the fruit is ripening, that dominant frequency is decreasing. So by this, we can predict the quality. Suppose if his frequency is more, it is in dry stage. When frequency is less, it is in ripened stage. So by measuring this frequency, we can measure the quality of fruit or vegetable. Similarly, in the case of electrical impedance also, electrical conductivity will increase with increase in the ripening. So you can see that overripen means conductivity is more, whereas raw fruit or unripe, conductivity is less. So just by putting two electrodes, we can measure the conductivity of the fruit and vegetable, and we can predict the quality of the fruit and vegetable. So by acoustic or by electrical conductivity method, we have optimized different parameters for different fruits and vegetables, and we can predict the quality of the fruit or vegetable without cutting the fruit. Acoustic is very good for measuring the quality where that any insect infestation or any worm or anything is there, then also that sound quality will change. So that is very good for that type of prediction. So this was about handling of fruits and vegetables in fresh form. Now I am going to talk for 10 to 15 minutes handling this development of value-added products. So whatever new technologies have come into the market for development of different value-added products from fruits and vegetables. So in a couple of minutes, I'm going to cover this topic also. So value addition. Value addition is done to get more commercial value, more shelf-life stability. Suppose tomato is there, if you are converting it to ketchup form, it will be having a shelf-life of 9 months. Tomato having a shelf-life of 1 week, 9 days only, 10 days only. So it will be more shelf-stable. Variation in type of product. From single variety of tomato, single tomato, you can make different variety of chutney, ketchup, sauce, pickle, or juice. Different type of products can be made from a single type of commodity. Then after processing, it will be having convenience in transportation and marketing also, and ultimately we are going to get more profit. So this is the benefit of value addition. And we are having certain technologies which are very good for these fruits and vegetables. At present market, you can see only canned fruits and vegetables are available, where in the case of cans, what happens that 50% around 50% will be sugar syrup. In the case of vegetables, it will be brine solution. And can cost is also more. So we have developed alternative technology for this canned products, where in flexible pouches, as such in PP pouches or polyethylene pouches, we can keep the fruits and vegetables and it can be pasteurized or sterilized also. So here there will be very less sugar syrup or no sugar syrup, and it is very convenient. Just open the packet, you can eat it. So that losses of that sugar syrup or can cost is very high. So all those things we can avoid in this case of hurdle technology fruits and vegetables. And products will be having shelf life of 3 months to 6 months depending on the type of the commodity. Then this is another technology, osmodehydration. Here in the case of dehydration, now different type of things have come. Right from sun drying, now then cabinet drying, solar drying, vacuum drying, microwave drying, infrared drying. So many dehydration techniques have come into the market. And using this advanced dehydration techniques, different type of fruits and vegetables can be dried. And it can be converted into very good type, good products. So this is like a osmodehydration. We have to just soak the fruits or vegetables in some sugar syrup along with some hydrocolloids, and followed by certain advanced drying method like microwave or vacuum drying method can be used, and very good quality chewable product can be developed using this fruits and vegetables. So these products also have been developed at DFRL, and the technology has been given to different entrepreneurs for commercialization. Beverages, new type of beverages also have come into market. Earlier it was mango juice, pineapple juice, so many. Now tender coconut water technology we have developed, and now tender coconut water either in flexible pouches or in bottles, this plastic bottles, it is available in the market. That is based on DFR technologies. Now sugarcane juice also coming into the market, beetroot juice, apricot juice. So many things now have been developed, new type of products have been developed in the beverage sector, and these technologies are coming into the market. Juice powders, earlier it was not there, only milk powder was being sold. Now juice powders, either by using spray drying technology or freeze drying technology, that type of juice powders, like this is beetroot juice powder or mango juice powder, these type of powders are also coming. And it can be just add water and your juice will be ready, like lassi powders, mango juice blended lassi powders. So many things are coming to the market. So these technologies are also available, and it can be used for development of value-added product from fruits and vegetables. Soup mixes, chutney mixes, using the different type of dehydration technologies can be made, and it can be easily marketed. This is a novel product we call as restructured fruits and vegetables. Market, you can see only jellies are available, fruit jelly or vegetable jellies are available, where it is by using gelatin or some other hydrocolloid that fruit or vegetable converted into jelly type of form, where that fruit or vegetable portion is very less or it is not there, only they are using essence of the fruit or vegetables. So in lieu of that, this new technology has been developed, we call it restructured, where 100% fruit or vegetable can be converted into gel type of form and can be preserved by using this other technology or canning process, and shelf life will be around 6 months to 1 year. So this is like natural 100% fruit and vegetable, guava, tomato, papaya, orange, muskmelon, anything. By using certain hydrocolloids, we can convert into the form of gels. So here 100% fruit gels are there, not whatever available in the market, that is 0% fruit, only flavor is there. Whereas in this case, 100% fruits pulp can be converted into gel type of form, and further it can be preserved by using canning or thermal processing technology. This is another innovative technology. For the first time, we have developed, and this is called vacuum assisted microwave dehydration. Because a normal dehydration process, it takes lot of energy, electricity. So, and because that drying time is very high, suppose if you want to dry potato cubes, it will take minimum 6 to 8 hours for drying. Same potato cubes, I can dry in vacuum assisted microwave drying system within 1 hour. So that type of energy saving will be there. So this is advanced technology where under vacuum and by using this microwave power, we can dry the fruits and vegetables. So this is a very good technology, and based on this technology, several value-added products have been developed, like cauliflower, peas, garlic. You can see normal drying, that garlic will be like shrinker. It will be hard dried. Whereas in the case of vacuum assisted microwave dried systems, you can see it will be like puffy. Texture will be there, puffiness is there. So if you are putting in water, automatically it will absorb water at a faster rate, whereas this cabinet dried product will take a lot of time for absorbing moisture. So this type of advantage is there. Similarly, in case of potatoes, you can see, suppose 600 microwave power, 300 millibar vacuum if you are drying, or 150 millibar vacuum you are drying, you are getting very good quality of the product. It is puffy in nature. If you are putting in hot water, within minute it will be reconstituted. Whereas 5 minute dried one, you can see that structure is not good and it will take more time for rehydration process. You can see from this slides also that structural slide, tissue structure, where in the case of hot rail drying, it is shrunken, whereas in the case of micro drying, the porous nature is maintained. And based on this type of dehydration technique, certain curry mixes have been developed, like cauliflower, potato, cauliflower, peas, along with this spice mix powder, and these type of things are going to the services in their ration. So different type of products can be developed using this technology, microwave assisted vacuum dehydration technology. This is very new technology, and maybe only this system is available in India at DFR. Then curry concentrate. Earlier, full curry was given to the services. Now curry concentrates are given, and where fresh fruit or fresh vegetables can be just put in this curries and put water and boil it, your curry will be ready. This type of products are also available. Curry cubes, this is another technology using this dehydration technology, different type of dehydration technology, that vegetable pieces along with the spices, salt, oil, everything is mixed and it is compressed in the form of bar. And this bar can go to the services and this can be converted within 4 to 5 minutes in boiling water. And one bar will give around 150 gram of the curry. So this type of products are also coming, will come into the market in the future. Then we are having technology for post processing, where different type of fruits and vegetables can be preserved by thermal sterilization and it can be kept for more than 1 year. Similarly, curries, we are having now new varieties of curry, like stub vegetable, very much popular in northern side. This type of vegetables, stub vegetables, can be retard processed and shelf life will be more than 1 month, one year. And it can be just consumed by opening the pouch and it can be consumed. This is another technology that is called vacuum frying. First one was vacuum dehydration by microwaves. This is another technology we call as vacuum frying. This is also first time developed in India. That machine has been developed in India for the first time at DFR. What happens? when you are frying potato, where starch is more, sugar is less, you can fry in open pan, open that kadhai and other things you can fry, where temperature will be around 160 degrees centigrade at the time of frying. But if you want to fry jackfruit or banana, ripe banana, or apples, or pears, or mango slices, or strawberry slices, if you are going to fry at 160 degrees centigrade in open pan, these products will become brown or black. It will be charred because of high amount of sugar present in that particular commodity. So for frying up these commodities, we have designed one machine that is called vacuum frying machine. This is the machine where under vacuum we fry the fruits and vegetables. So here temperature we maintain 80 to 90 degrees centigrade, and under vacuum we fry the fruits and vegetables. So you can see from here that color of the commodity is maintained. Suppose this commodity, carrot or beetroot or anything, if you are frying in that open pan at 160 degrees centigrade, it will become completely black. Whereas if you are frying these type of commodities in vacuum fryer, the golden color or green color, green vegetables or purple color will be maintained as such in the final chips. So this is a very good technology. Already we have given 5 technology transfers for this technology, vacuum frying of fruits and vegetables to different forms. And you can see in the market also, now the products have started coming in the market. A lot of companies, now they are marketing these type of vacuum fried products. This is a very good technology. And here that nutrient retention, color retention, vitamin retention also will be better as compared to the conventional frying method. In the case of frozen fruits and vegetables, technology for blast freezing and IQF, individual quick freezing, has been developed. And these technologies are very good for maintaining the quality of fruits and vegetables in frozen form. So both blast freezing with the fruits and vegetables, and it will freeze the commodity within few hours. Whereas in the case of IQF, that it is another very good technology where that this type of where that structure is there, that strawberries, blueberries, or peas, all those things are frozen using this IQF technology. And in frozen condition at minus 18 degrees centigrade, they can be kept for more than a year. So this is a very good technology for keeping fruits and vegetables in frozen form for longer duration. Then coming to the non-thermal technologies, there is a problem of loss of nutrients in fruits and vegetables when you are subjecting the fruits and vegetables to high temperatures like thermal sterilization or pasteurization or thermal processing. So to overcome this problem, this non-thermal technologies have come into the market, like high pressure processing, pulse electric field processing, ozone processing, ultrasound, pulse light processing. So here that high pressure and pulse electric, basically, these are processing technologies where ozone, ultrasound, pulse light, all those things are phytosanitation. Basically, these three technologies are used for phytosanitation. Whereas these first two technologies are used for processing purposes, for preservation purposes. So these technologies are very good. In case of high pressure, pressure is applied instead of temperature. In case of pulse electric field, electric current is used instead of thermal processing. So this is the high pressure processing system at DFRL, where we just process the, instead of using thermal sterilization, we just give pressure here, and that in the range of more than 600 to 800 megapascals, that much pressure we give. And at that pressure, most of the microorganisms, they are getting inactivated and product will be kept for longer duration. So a lot of things like fruits, vegetables, juices, tender coconut water, sugar cane juice, cut fruits, jam, condiment paste, cereal pulses, veg, non-veg products also we have optimized for high pressure processing at DFRL Mysore. These are some experimental details. Suppose if you are doing that beetroot juice, that shelf life will be better. Condiment paste, ginger paste, garlic paste, all those shelf life can be maintained. Jam type of product can be prepared using high pressure processing technology. Paneer type of products can be prepared and preserved using this high pressure processing. Then similar in the case of pulse electric field, this where electric current in the tune of 20 to 80 kilovolt per centimeter, that much strength we have to use to inactivate the microorganisms. Here the technology is basically, it creates some pores in the cell wall of the microorganism, that is called electroporation. And when pores are sufficient in number, that cell wall will rupture and bacteria will be dead. So this is the technology. By using this technology, this is basically used for liquid products, but now some machines have come that that can be used for the solid food applications also. So this is having wonderful application in the case of this juice extraction for solid items also, sugar beet, sugar extraction from sugar beets, or it can be used for that juice extraction also. It can be used for oil extraction also. Suppose that seed oils, that cotton seed oil or something, any other mustard seeds or anything can be treated with pulse electric field, and yield of the oil will be more as compared to the conventional treatments. Similarly, this extraction of plant oils also can be given pulse electric field treatment, and oil extraction will be much better as compared to the normal conventional methods. You can see the results also where pulse electric field treatment has been given, oil extraction is more as compared to the reference. Similarly, from algal sources also, oil can be extracted by using the pulse electric field technology. So not only it is having application in liquids for juice and milk and other things, it can be used for the solid food applications also. It can be used for this freezing treatments also. It can be a process add for the huddle processing also. So a lot of things can be done using this pulse electric field technology. And the technology is ozonation, where gaseous ozone is used for surface sanitation or cleaning of the fruits and vegetables. It is more effective as compared to the other that chemicals, whatever being used, like hypochlorite, chloramine, hypochlorous acid. So it is more effective than this chemical. So this is basically used, and it can be applied for surface sanitation of the fruits and vegetables. You can see that yeast mold count, or total plate count, coliform count can be reduced by using this ozone treatment. Now, a lot of ozonators are coming in the market also. You can see in market, small ozonators are coming for household applications also. So it can be used for that phytosanitation wash, as a phytosanitation treatment. Ultrasonics also, it can be also used for as a phytosanitary measure. It can be used for different other applications also, and it is very effective, and can be used for this fruits and vegetables. Similarly, pulse light also, or UV light also, can be used for surface sanitation of the fruits and vegetables. So these are basic technologies, non-thermal technologies, which can be applied for different fruits and vegetables, and to maintain their quality during storage. You can see different treatments. So these are basically what I was supposed to talk on, development of different type of post-harvest handling technologies, as well as different processing technologies. Now coming to the last part of my talk today, this we are now working on this Gaganyaan mission. So we are giving different type of food products as well as delivery systems for this our space mission, which is called as Gaganyaan. Next year most probably it is going to happen. So three astronauts are going in this Gaganyaan mission. We have to supply, we have to give different, for 7 days it will be in orbit, and we have to give different food products for them. So in case of that space foods, these are the basic criteria. It should be well packed, is digestible, convenience, easy storageable, safe disposal, lightweight, balanced nutrition. So all these are the basic criteria, and these are the basically classification of this space foods. So food can be rehydratable, means ready to reconstitute type of product, thermostabilized type of product, irradiated foods, intermediate moisture foods, and here is the category for fresh fruits and vegetables. So natural fresh fruits and vegetables can be given in the space, but it should be thoroughly phytosanitized. There should not be any bacterial or fungal counts on the surface of fruits and vegetables. So this fresh fruits and vegetables can be given to the space after due phytosanitation measures. So fruits and vegetables are initially sanitized by chlorine or some other methods, and it has to be kept in some suitable polymeric bags to preserve their freshness, and it can be given to the astronauts for their consumption in space mission. So like apple, banana, oranges, all those things we are going to give for this space mission also. And another thing, now that NASA, this is not for India, this is for that NASA ISS space station. So now they are cultivating different type of vegetables in the space access. And that are using this different type of like hydroponic systems, and using certain type of lights, artificial lights, they are growing different type of vegetables. Now that wheat also they are growing at NASA station. So this type of things now it is happening in the post harvest of this fruits and vegetables. So with this I am going to conclude my talk. So is as such, India is equipped with a range of post harvest technologies for fresh handling as well as for development of value-added products. However, there is need for development of suitable marketing network, infrastructural development, including of packaging houses, cold storage, refrigerated transport, all those things we have to give more emphasis to promote the culture of value addition. Extension and training works need to be undertaken in rural and semi-urban areas to bring about awareness of food processing at grassroots level. Now we have done certain experiments in Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh, where we have gone to the different villages and we have taught them how to do value addition, basically in the area of tomato processing, because they are growing a lot of tomatoes and a lot of commodities are getting spoiled. Farmers are not getting proper price. So we have gone there, we have installed certain units also, and now they are doing certain tomato processing, they are making certain products and selling them. So that type of experiments or that type of extension works need to be carried out in other states also, other areas also. And at Defense Food Research Laboratory, we are not only serving to the armed forces, but we are having technologies which can be easily adopted by Indian industries for making some user-friendly technologies and for making different types of products. And they can commercialize the products also. So with this, thank you very much once again for giving me opportunity for this hard talk. And I'm thankful to the organizers for this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, and sparing us valuable time, sir, and congratulations. So many viewers, we have some question, so we can put it one by one.
So, Dr. Molly Paul, tell about condition of green pea during storage. Green pea, that's what, as such, if you are doing green peas, old rooms, as such, there is no problem. But now in India, there is some achievements in green pea sector. Now most of the green peas, you can see that is only coming in the frozen form. So that frozen form, green peas are very good, and it is having very good shelf-life, 9 months to 1 year, that type of shelf-life is coming. Otherwise, if you are keeping the green peas in cold room conditions, it can be it will be having a shelf-life about a few months only. Most of the companies like Safal and other things, now they are selling the green peas in frozen form by using IKF technique. Next one.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, again, same CO2 absorbers. This not only sometimes what happens when you are doing this O2 CO2 manipulation in the cold rooms, sometimes what happens if you are not monitoring properly, CO2 rate increases, CO2 accumulation increases. So for that, different type of scrubbers are used, like that KOS or some other chemicals are being used, which absorb this carbon dioxide. Otherwise, we can put simple exhaust. Now this automatic controls are coming and sensors are there. So when CO2 level increases a particular level, automatically it will be exhausted. So that type of fans, that type of controls are available in CO storage chambers. So that type of things are very good. Next one.
Appreciation coming, Padam Shri Awardee, Dr. Brahma Singh.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Another appreciation, Dr. A.K. Pandit, very informative.
Thank you.
Amarjeet Kaur, very informative. Rijajuddin Ahmed, nice slides. So many people they commented. One more question coming, sir, if you want to give answers.
Yes, this retort pouches, earlier what was there, that retort was same and cans were being used, where that lacquered cans or that tin cans were used for this fruits and vegetables or curries or different type of food products. So now that technology has been replaced by this retort pouch processing technology, where that four layer retort pouches are used, where that aluminium layer is also there, PP layer is there, nylon layer is there. So that type of four layers are there, and that are very good, and we can process the fruits and vegetables or this different type of food products in that retort pouches, and it will sustain that 121 degree centigrade temperature for a particular period of time. So that is very good, and that type of pouches are available in the market. That first work we started at DFRL only, that pouches. So now it has completely replaced that tins. in that rations. Earlier, that rations were going in tins. Now we are giving in retard pouches only.
Thank
so
you,
it
sir.
Is basically four layer pouch. As a sugar juice debittering, this citrus juice debittering, that is the naringenase enzyme is there. One enzyme, that naringenase, that chemical is being used for this debittering of citrus juices. So you purchase that naringenase and just try with that different labels. It will debitter the citrus juices. Challenge. Next one, anything? This already I answered, that naringenase enzyme can be used for citrus juice debittering.
One more question, sir.
Anu Verma, sir, can we have project behind? Yes, DRDO SS gives funding also, like DST, DBT, Ministry of Food Processing. So DRDO is also having a funding body that is called Life Sciences Research Board. Another funding body is there, ER and IPR, that is also in DRDO headquarters. So these two are the funding bodies, and we give projects to different institutes or universities from these two sources. So they can apply directly to LSRB, or they can apply to the ER and IPR cell.
Dr. Shailendra Dwivedi is commenting, very nice.
Thank you,
and thank
you, Shailendra. Thank you.
Molly Paul, almost fruits are processed at temperature of 100 degree while vegetables are, what is the reason?
This is basically because of that sugar content. So different, not only 100 or 121, as per that requirement. Suppose tea coffee, now we are giving ready to drink tea coffee, so that we are processing at different temperatures. So depending on the requirements of fruit or vegetable, we process at different temperatures.
Nice presentation, sir. Very informative.
Thank you.
One more question is coming, sir.
Aflatoxin in dry ginger.
Hello.
Aflatoxin, basically, if you are doing, actually, that type of problem, I have not come across dry ginger aflatoxin. Basically, it is in cereals only. So if any aflatoxin is there in dry ginger, either it can be thermally processed, otherwise this ozone or this washing treatments also reduce the aflatoxin. We have tested in our lab also, this aflatoxin content can be reduced by ozone treatment or ultrasonic treatment. So that type of treatments also can be used. Otherwise, this microalgae, if you are going for dehydration, you can first you wash it properly and then go for this microwave or IR dehydration, then it can be reduced, that aflatoxin level also can be reduced.
Anu Verma, okay, sir, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for wonderful talk. Audience, please send your query and question to Progressive Horticulture @gmail.com. Response for audience was tremendous with very encouraging remark. We are highly grateful, sir, to you for sparing time and delivering such an important talk. Thank you, audience, for your active participation and support. Thank you, sir. And sir, congratulations. And again, comments is coming. It will go on, you know, all over globe. Anybody can watch all over globe on YouTube, Facebook. They will watch. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much for giving this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Mahavir Singh. Okay, thank you. Nice. Thanks. Excellent presentation. He's commenting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you a lot, sir.
Thank you. Namaskar.
Namaskar, sir. Jai Hind.